The blaze of the sun wrung pops of sweat from the old man's brow, yet he cupped his hands around the glass of hot, sweet tea, as if to warm them. He could not shake the premonition. It clanged to his back like chill, wet leaves. The dig was over. The tell had been sifted, stratum by stratum, its entrails examined, tagged, and shipped. The beds and pendants, glyptics, phalli, ground stone mortars stained with ochre, burnished pots, nothing exceptional, an Assyrian ivory toilet box, and man, the bones of man, the brittle remnants of cosmic torment that once made him wonder if matter was Lucifer, upward groping back to his god. And yet now he knew better. The fragrance of licorice plant and tamarisk tugged his gaze to poppied hills, to reeded plains, to the ragged rock-strewn bolt of road that flung itself headlong into dread. Northwest was Mosul, east Erbil, south was Baghdad and Kirkuk, and the fiery furnace of Nebuchadnezzar. He shifted his legs underneath the table in front of the lonely roadside chaikina and stared at the grass stains on his boots and khaki pants. He sipped at his tea. The dig was over. What was beginning? He dusted the thought like a clay-fresh find, but he could not tag it. Someone wheezed from within the chaikina, the withered proprietor shuffling towards him, kicking up dust in Russian-made shoes that he wore like slippers, groaning backs pressed under his heels. The dark of his shadow slipped over the table. Kamenchai? Chawaga? The man in khaki shook his head, staring down at the laceless, crusted shoes, caked thick with debris of the pain of living. The stuff of the cosmos, he softly reflected. Matter, yet somehow finally spirit. Spirit and the shoes were to him but aspects of a stuff more fundamental, a stuff that was primal and totally other. The shadow shifted. The Kurd stood waiting like an ancient debt. The old man in khaki looked up into eyes that were damply bleached, as if the membrane of an eggshell had been pasted over the irises. Glaucoma. Once he could not have loved this man. He slipped out his wallet and probed for a coin among its tattered, crumpled tenants. A few dinars, an Iraqi driver's license, a faded plastic calendar card that was 12 years out of date. It bore an inscription on the reverse. What we give to the poor is what we take with us when we die. The card had been printed by the Jesuit missions. He paid for his tea and left a tip of 50 fils on a splintered table the color of sadness. He walked to his Jeep. The gentle rippling click of key sliding into ignition was crisp in the silence. For a moment he waited, feeling at the stillness. Clustered on the summit of a towering mound, the fractured rooftops of Erbil hovered far in the distance. Poised in the clouds like a rubbled, mud-stained benediction, the leaves clutched tighter at the flesh of his back. Something was waiting. Allah Ma'ak Chuwaga. Rotted teeth, the Kurd was grinning, waving farewell. The man in khaki groped for a warmth in his pit of his being and came up with a wave and a mustard smile. It dimmed as he looked away. He started the engine, turned in a narrow, eccentric U and headed toward Mosul. The Kurd stood watching, puzzled by a heart-dropping sense of loss, as the Jeep gathered speed. What was it that was gone? What was it he had felt in the stranger's presence? Something like safety, he remembered, a sense of protection and deep well-being. Now it dwindled in the distance with the fast-moving Jeep. He felt strangely alone. The painstaking inventory was finished by 6:10. The Mosul curator of antiquities, an Arab with sagging cheeks, was carefully penning a final entry into the ledger on his desk. For a moment he paused, looking up at his friend, as he dipped his pen point into an inkpot. The man in khaki seemed lost in thought. He was standing by a table, hand in his pocket, staring down at some dry, tagged whisper of the past. The curator observed him, curious, unmoving, then returned to the entry, writing in a firm, very small, neat script. Then at last he sighed, setting down the pen as he noted the time. The train to Baghdad left at 8. He blotted the page and offered tea. The man in khaki shook his head, his eyes still fixed upon something on the table. The Arab watched him, vaguely troubled. What was in the air? There was something in the air. He stood up and moved closer, then felt a vague prickling at the base of his neck as his friend at last moved, reaching down for an amulet and cradling it pensively in his hand. It was a green stone head of the demon Pazuzu, personification of the southwest wind. Its dominion was sickness and disease. The head was pierced. The amulet's owner had worn it as a shield. Evil against evil, breathed the curator languidly, fanning himself with a French scientific periodical. An olive oil thumbprint smudged on the cover. His friend did not move. He did not comment. Is something wrong? No answer. Father? The man in khaki still appeared not to hear, absorbed in the amulet. The last of his finds. After a moment, he set it down, then lifted a questioning look to the Arab. Had he said something? Nothing. They murmured farewells. At the door, the curator took the old man's hand with an extra firmness. My heart has a wish, father, that you would not go. His friend answered softly in terms of tea, of times, of something to be done. No, no, no. I meant home. The man in khaki fixed his gaze on a speck of boiled chickpea nestled in a corner of the Arab's mouth, yet his eyes were distant. Home, he repeated. The word had the sound of an ending. The States, the Arab curator added, instantly wondering why he had. The man in khaki looked into the dark of the other's concern. He had never found it difficult to love this man. Goodbye, he whispered, then quickly turned and stepped into the gathering gloom of the streets, and a journey home whose length seemed somehow undetermined. I will see you in a year, the curator called after him from the doorway. But the man in khaki never looked back. The Arab watched his dwindling form as he crossed a narrow street at an angle, almost colliding with a swiftly moving droshky. Its cab bore a corpulent old Arab woman, her face a shadow behind the black lace veil draped loosely over her like a shroud. He guessed she was rushing to some appointment. He soon lost sight of his hurrying friend. The man in khaki walked, compelled. Shrugging loose of the city, he breached the outskirts, crossing the Tigris. Nearing the ruins, he slowed his pace, for with every step, the inchoate presentiment took firmer, more horrible form. Yet he had to know. He would have to prepare. A wooden plank that bridged the Kasr, a muddy stream, creaked under his weight. And then he was there. He stood on the mound where once gleamed 15-gated Nineveh, feared nest of Assyrian hordes. Now the city lay sprawled in the bloody dust of its predestination. And yet he was here. The air was still thick with him, the other who ravaged his dreams. A Kurdish watchman rounded a corner, unslung his rifle, and began to run toward him, then abruptly stopped and grinned with a wave of recognition, and proceeded on his rounds. The man in khaki prowled the ruins, the temple of Nabu, the temple of Ishtar. He sifted vibrations. At the palace of Ashurbanipal, he paused, then shifted a sidelong glance to a limestone statue hulking in situ, ragged wings, taloned feet, bulbous, jutting, stubby penis, and a mouth stretched taut in a feral grin. The demon, Pazuzu. Abruptly, he sagged. He knew it was coming. He stared at the dust, quickening shadows. He heard dim yappings of savage dog packs, prowling the fringes of the city. The orb of the sun was beginning to fall below the rim of the world. He rolled his shirt sleeves down and buttoned them as a shivering breeze sprang up. Its source was southwest. He hastened toward Mosul and his train, his heart encased in the icy conviction that soon he would face an ancient enemy.